Želim vam svima ugodno popodne. Evo tako. Puno hvala na svemu što ste do sada tako lepo držali. Mogli ste još duže, ja sam mogao da budem kraći. Ali hvala i na gostoprimstvu. Ne znam kako da se ponašam prema onima koji jako dobro govore engleski, a možda dobro ne razumeju naš jezik. Da li imam pravo da govorim engleski? In this case, I would suggest to put my presentation on screen because it is in English. It will be helpful to all those who are following. Even if you don't understand English, at least you will better understand what is the message through the slides. I don't know if it is possible for me to connect. No? Okay. Very good. I chose for this afternoon because I understood that you are talking about the importance of family life. Am I right? We are talking about the importance of family life. I chose a very difficult text and not very polite for those who don't care about their families. And this is biblical. And this is in 1 Timothy chapter 5. If I can find an English Bible, I would really appreciate it because I have here just the Bible in our language. Thank you so much. Excellent. 1 Timothy is a very interesting book. You can call it in different way, explain what is inside. I would just suggest that the summary of the book. Sorry, it will take just 1 minute, even less, for me to find the way to make it public. This is 6:11. So you will find it easily. Very good. And pictures are big. This is why. Not responding? No, it is right now. So let me close here. This is for you. Thank you so much. And you will find the date of today. And this is it's not always easy to switch from one language to another, but we will try to do our best. And if you read this text, I would suggest that 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15 is a summary of what we find in this small book. And I'm reading with you. 1 Timothy 3:15. But if I am delayed, I write so. He says, I'm writing something. So this text that was written by the Apostle Paul, he wrote it so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God. So this is a practical guide for everybody coming to the church. So if you want to be a good member in good standing, it is good for you to read First Timothy, the book of five chapters. But I would like to say that within so many topics that you have in First Timothy, there are some crucial elements that are essential. You cannot avoid to know this. And the first one is, when you read Timothy chapter 1, and it is, let's say, verse 5. I'm using what is in Greek, the same construction of sentences. So I will give you five of them that you understand what is essential. So I'm telling 1 Timothy chapter 1, and then verse 5. The text says, "Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith, from which some, having strayed, have turned aside to the wrong direction." Let's say something like this. So the first thing he says, people have problem with commandments. They don't understand the concept of God's law. And they, if I read, I can continue. So verse 7, 1 Timothy 1, 7. "Desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say, nor the things which they affirm." So it is very curious to be a teacher, not knowing what we are teaching. When I was in France, I was told, so when we study French, I was studying in order to become a professor of French outside of a French-speaking country. This is like ESL, which means English as second language. FSL is French as second language. When you study this, they told us very often, if you want to teach French to John, you need to know French and John. This is how it is. If you don't know John, it is possible that your teaching will not reach him. You will just teach, and the final result will not necessarily be a good one, adapted to his case. Excellent. Thank you so much. Very good. So there are some people having problem with God's law, God's commandment. And the text says, when you continue, "But we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous person, but for the lawless and unsubordinate, for the ungodly and for sinners." So you understand well, there are people, you can read this in Colossians, mainly chapter 3. The Apostle Paul says to people there, he says, "Why do you come back to the basic fundamental things?" And he says, "Do not touch, do not eat, do not drink." Why are you doing so? Are you free? Are you free in Jesus Christ? How it is possible that you are like small children? You cannot be at the level of small children. Small children, they don't think. They don't think. They just obey. This is how it happens. But the text that we have here, 1 Timothy, is telling us that there is a problem. If you don't understand well God's law, you can go in the wrong direction. The second thing is about, when you read chapter 1, verse 19, you will see something very interesting. "Having faith and a good conscience, which some, having rejected concerning the faith, have suffered shipwreck." And so you can understand the second problem for someone to be a good member in good standing is they don't understand the question of conscience. Why is it a problem? I remember my daughter, when she was a baby, she came to the kitchen. And you can understand that the kitchen is a very dangerous place for small children. You cannot negotiate. If they want to touch something that is very dangerous for them, you don't explain, you don't convince, you just say, do not touch. Because you want to save them from problems. The problem with Christians is that you cannot always work just on the basis of not thinking. You need to come to the level of thinking. And that level of thinking is what we call here good conscience. What is the conscience? The conscience is the capacity of someone to say this is good or this is wrong. This is the conscience. So if you don't care about your capacity to decide, then on a long-term basis you will be a wrong Christian. You will just obey blindly without knowing how to adapt you and your situation to a given situation. So I'm just willing to suggest something to you, just to think very seriously. When I say conscience, do you know what is the baptism? Just to help us to understand everything. What is the baptism? What is your point of view about baptism? I need a definition of baptism. What is for you baptism?
Public declaration to be on God's side.
Yes. Very good. Very good. This is good. How do you express this? Sorry, publicly? You make what kind of promise?
To serve.
You commit yourself how? To be perfect?
No, to serve God.
Just to be almost perfect.
No.
Just to be
obedient?
Only obedient? This is not true, I'm telling you. But because if you commit yourself to be obedient, you need to admit even before the baptism that you will not be 100% obedient. If you are 100% obedient, then you will be perfect. You understand the question? So, when you make your commitment, you make a commitment of what? Exactly. This is good. But, yes? That you belong to God. Could you please help me? Holy Spirit, you are going closer and closer. This is going in the right direction. Let's try together to find Peter. Peter's definition of baptism. Do you remember the definition of Peter? What does he say? First Peter chapter 3, starting with verse 21. Who will read this text? Yeah? Yeah, you can read.
So, First Peter chapter 3, verse 21.
Yes, and 22.
Gone into heaven and is on the right hand of God, powers being made subject unto him.
Thank you so much. I just want to tell you that when you make your commitment and you lie, the entire universe knows about your lie. This is how it happens. You cannot promise to be perfect. You cannot. Because I know that you will not be perfect. You are a sinner. And when you come here, you will understand that the text says very well that the baptism is the promise of, what is the promise of what? Good conscience. What is the meaning of good conscience? The promise of good conscience. There are some texts of prophets who said, they said so strongly, they say, blessed are those who are always faithful to God. Wow, to those who are calling black, white, and white, white, black. Who are telling that something is true and this is lie, and telling that lie is the truth. This is the problem. When we make our commitment, we make a commitment that independently of our actions, we will always call the sin by its name. You understand the point? We admit that even when we commit sin, we will not try to justify sin. We will recognize that something is wrong. And when we come to God, we will come with the spirit of repentance. This is why, you understand the question of good conscience. Good conscience is giving us the opportunity to say, this is good and this is wrong. This is what we promise to tell God. We say, whatever the circumstance is, we don't believe that we will be perfect on our own. We need the power of God. We need you to help us to be in the likeness of Jesus. When we say this, we say, it is possible that we will commit sins. And if you want to read the First John chapter 1, if someone say, I don't commit sins. You are a liar. This is the Bible, it's not me. The Bible tells you, don't try to make God, or I don't know how to say, don't try to mess with all these important things, because sin is a huge problem. We cannot just deal with this question lightly. We need to do in God's way. And the Bible says, when you go through the baptism, you are not committing yourself to be perfect. You are committing to be always on God's side, as you said very well. You are committing to live through the power of the Holy Spirit. This is what we said very well. But we say, when we come to a situation that we are doing things wrongly, we will not try to justify our point of view, to diminish the problem of sin. We will say that sin is sin and that good things are good things. This is the commitment of good conscience. Let me tell you something. The main problem for education of children is not the problem of obedience. This is very, very, very important. But the main problem for the education of children, for them, is to learn how to make good choices and how to make good decisions. Amen. To know what is right and what is wrong. And you need the context. You need the context, the right context, a friendly context where you can make a wrong decision in order to learn from your experience that it is wrong. And it is much better that you do this in a Christian family, not outside. Because outside, when you make mistakes, you will be under the control of some other powers. And this is very dangerous, especially in some age of, let's say, teenagers will have hard problem when they do mistakes outside of their families. This is why I say it is crucial not only to learn to obey, but to learn how to make difference between good and evil, and how to make the right decision to do good. And this is a long-term training. You need to be trained to make decisions. If you are only in your family learning how to obey, and you heard so many times parents telling, just do so because I told you so. Do you know this kind of education? And after, when you become teenager, then I will try to explain to you. If you do so for years, when they become teenagers, they will not willing to listen your answer. This is not interesting for them. They need to have a trusting relationship, because when they learn to obey, they learn not to think, just to obey. They need to learn more than to obey. They need to understand what is in front of them and to say, yeah, this is wrong because of this, and this is good because of this. I will make the good choice, even if it is costly. And this is essential. There are so many people who grew up within the church and who were obedient for years and years and years. And they came in an age, let's say 30, 35, 40. They left their families, their children, their church, and they came on their own because they wanted to have control of their life. They just refused to obey, to obey, and to obey. Because if obedience is sufficient, God would not need to give us the so sophisticated brain, as you said before. This is fantastic what is there. The frontal lobe, where the center of our capacity to make choices has to be put into contribution. And if we don't have care of this on a long-term basis, we will lose people. So I'm just telling, the first thing that we had was, people need to understand that the law exists to help people. The wrong understanding of God's commandment will lead us out of faith. This is the reality. We need to understand that God's commandments are good for our freedom. Obeying God is just giving us the opportunity to build our freedom on solid ground. The second thing is, we need to understand that our commitment to God is the commitment of good conscience. We need to learn to take the right decisions. And the best place to do so is in our families. The third thing, completely at the end of 1 Timothy, just the last verse, when you go at the end, verse 12 and 21, verse 20 and 21. Who will read 1 Timothy 6, 20 and 21? Please, someone to read. 1 Timothy 6, 20 and 21. Falsely called knowledge. Today, in our society, We are overwhelmed with knowledge. I saw so many times that when I preach, I say something about an information regarding Old Testament, New Testament, any theologian or whatever, even quoting Ellen White, I saw young people Google, and immediately they verify what I say. Immediately. They are not waiting after the sermon. They are not taking notes. They verify immediately. Today we have too much information. Unfortunately, we have falsely called knowledge. Go to the internet and choose anything to do as research, and you will find garbage everywhere. You study music, you will find so many wrong information. You try to study Seventh-day Adventists, but you will find all kind of garbage. Because this is the superficiality of Google. This is very friendly, close to you. You can use anywhere, even right now in your airplane. Go flight, I don't know, internet. You open your cell phone and suddenly I saw 8 messages. And I wanted to consult. They say you have to pay $7.99 in order to read your messages. So I said, okay, the next time. But you see, they're giving you the opportunity to have access to all kind of knowledge. And the Bible is telling you, you need to make the difference between the true knowledge and the falsely called knowledge. And to be honest, as Christians, we can understand that the eternal life, John 17:3. What is the eternal life? The definition. Let's read together. John 17:3. John 17. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So basically, knowledge is so important. And the true knowledge gives you access to the eternal life. The eternal life is to know God and to know Jesus Christ. This is why it is very important that we make difference between false knowledge and true knowledge. And I'm just telling you that the best way to do so is, of course, in the church, but mainly in the families. You can grow without having the danger of following the false called knowledge. Because when you are doing your research, when you learn new things, you will understand that your parents are willing to give you access to the true knowledge, and they want to avoid you all inconvenience of those who are following false called knowledge. This is fundamental. Let me come to another aspect when we read 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 1 to 8. Who will read for me? Who will read for me? This is the text. Oh. Here. Sorry. Where is the text? I thought that it was at the beginning. Yeah. This one. Some of you, I don't want to talk too much. Someone to read this text. Thank you in advance. The text is on the...
Do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, with all purity. Honor widows who are really widows. But if any widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show Now she who is really a widow and left alone trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. And these things command that they may be blameless. But if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever.
Thank you so much. This is the same kind of sentence that you have here when you read, if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith. Do you understand how important this aspect was? Do you know the consequences of someone at the time of the Apostle Paul when it was written? If someone said, I don't believe in God, what would happen for him at the time of the Apostle Paul? If you say, I don't believe in God. If you read the five books of Moses, for those who deny the faith, they will be stoned. This is how it happened. Why is it so important? Let me insist, this is crucial for my presentation. If you don't care about your family, you are worse than an unbeliever, which means that the priority number one, after being connected with God, is for you to take care of your family, to invest in your family, to spend time with your family, to spend time with children, with your spouse, with everything that will make your family strong. This is the basic element of your Christian experience. If you are not at that level, you are denying the faith. You cannot preach the gospel to people. You cannot be the light, as you said before. You cannot be the life while living in darkness. It's not possible. If your family is in darkness, you have nothing to say to others. You are even a danger for the society. This is, at that time, they considered that someone who denies the faith, he is totally wrong. We need to eliminate him. This is how they said. They could stone. They could stone even for less than this at that time. I'm not telling that we will stone people, but I'm just telling when the Apostle Paul says he has denied the faith, it means he is very serious. And he said, your 28 fundamental beliefs are nothing because you don't care about your family. This is what he wants to say. You know everything about the Trinity. Fine. But you are not caring about your children, your family. The first aspect of Christian life is strong family. The church cannot destroy the family life. The church has to serve family. Sometimes we are not respecting enough our families. We are just multiplying activities and activities and activities. At the end, in this crazy world, there is no time for our families. And the Bible says that we, as the church, we are a family. We are inspired by the family. Look at this. Everything here is telling us that the church is a big family. And he says here, in your church. So basically, let me give you an illustration. The Apostle Paul is a high-ranked officer of the church. He is among the apostles. So let's say something like this. He is the North American division president. And he is talking to a young pastor who will start his work. And he is telling him in all these texts, he says, treat everybody as members of your own family. So the first thing that you can say When you read this text, he says, be positive. Do not rebuke. I grew up in a Yugoslavian culture, Yugoslavian concept. And our church was, my church, Niš, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Niš, some know the church in Niš, was very, very, very conservative church. I remember that one of my friends, a young girl from the high school, came to the church. At that time, we had some problems with the miniskirt. And according to the deacons, it was too short. And they had a meeting of deacons, and they established a new rule valid for the church in Niš. And they said, only three fingers above the half of the knee. You understand the meaning? So it is not around, but it is from the half of the knee you count three fingers. But you will count fingers not when a lady is standing, but when she is sitting at the church. And you come and you look. If it is shorter than three fingers, then you will call the deacons and they will bring something, I don't know, a jacket. How you say? Not only scarf. Mantle. How we can call this? Coat. A coat, you have three options, and the deacon with experience will just know exactly which one to bring to you. And so the deacon will come to that lady from my high school, say, please, could you come with me? I would like to tell you something very important. You know, the way how you came to the church for us is not acceptable. So we would like to give you this. And the next time, we would like to see you again. But the next time, please come with something a little bit longer. My friend left, and she never wanted to continue to attend the meeting. So I grew up in this context. And I understand what is the meaning. I understand what is the meaning when we are too harsh. You understand the question? You are just thinking, I need to tell them all the truth. And we tell all the truth to everybody, and we lose so many people. Because we say the truth, but love we forget. And if you communicate the truth without love, this is not the truth. Do you understand me? This is biblically, this is not the truth. Let me give you the next slide. This is what Ellen White said. This is the text about Sabbath school work. She said that she considered that some Sabbath school are too harsh. And this is a text for superintendent, vođa subotne škole. She said, superintendent, never scold. You understand the word never? Which means no circumstances can be a justification for you to use negative way of teaching people. Never scold nor complain before your teachers or scholars. If you wish to influence the school for good, put away the whip and exert a heaven inspiring influence, which will carry the minds of all with you. In some schools, in some Sabbath schools, there is a sharp critical spirit. Much is made of forms and rules, while the weightier matters, mercy and the love of God, are neglected. Let all be cheerful. If any have clouds encompassing their souls, let them work out into the sunlight before they enter the Sabbath school. Listen to this very carefully. A mother who is constantly relating her discouragements and complaining to her children of their lack of appreciation cannot have proper control of them. Do you understand the word cannot? It means cannot. This is the result. If you want to influence someone, you can do so if they trust you. If they don't trust you, you cannot influence them. In order to influence them, they still need to see that behind there is love. There is no love, there is no trusting relationship. This is how it happens. So basically, sometimes we say as it is here, as it was in my church, we think that before was much better because we were very, you know, and if you are strict, I have no problem to be strict, but if people cannot see love in everything that you are doing, you are not representing Jesus Christ. This is how it is. Very simple. But the reality is education is possible only if through this educational relationship people receive your love. If they don't receive love, there is no education. Education is possible only with love. So if you want influence, a mother who is always complaining, oh, my children are not doing well, you are just preparing your children to continue to be who they are. If you want them to change, then you need to change also your vocabulary and to tell them, I see a huge potential in you. Then they will start to think differently. Am I against rules? No. I'm first in favor of rules. I suffered with my violin, and I understood that you can do nothing without discipline. But even Buddha, you know, the founder of Buddhists, he said, I was looking for nirvana. This was his way of doing it. He was trying to find nirvana. And he said, I was following the best teachers that I had around me. And he said, I thought that nirvana can be found through the discipline. And I was fasting more than any other disciple. And I can confirm you, all my disciples, that the nirvana cannot be found in discipline. Because, I understand this, if you are disciplined enough, you can do all the rules, and if there is no love, at the end when you fulfilled all the rules, there is a lack of relationship of quality, which is only possible with love. So basically, yes, I'm in favor of rules. My wife knows my problems. My problems right now is that I have 6 different time zones in my district across Canada. So basically, I have British Columbia, Pacific time, then Alberta, then Manitoba, Saskatchewan, then Ontario, my time. Then I have Maritime time, and then I have Newfoundland time. So 6 different time zones. And I know that from the Bible, from Ellen White, I need to be well organized. And I know that Ellen White says, eat always in regular hours. This is better for your body. How can I eat in regular hours? Because sometimes I'm sleeping from 10 to 3 o'clock Oshawa time. Sometimes I'm sleeping all the time in other time zones. If I'm just thinking about rules, I will have a hard time to do something meaningful for myself. I need to use my brain to adapt myself for my given situation and still to be meaningful observing all rules, all useful rules, but not blindly, just through my connection with God. And I will adapt myself in the best way possible. And sometimes it will not be exactly as my wife knows that I have to do. This is how it happens. Or sometimes I will think that my wife can do better than she is doing. But I need to admit that it is not myself who can control her or herself who can control myself. But together we are trying to create the right context where everybody can grow. And this is the question. The Sabbath school exists for people to grow. And the reason why we are not regular on Sabbath school is because we don't see that we are growing. The question is not that people are, they just give up. They give up because they don't see meaning. They see too many sermons during the Sabbath school. They see too many rules during the Sabbath school. They see so many conflicts during the Sabbath school. And they don't see that everything is to help people to know better Jesus Christ. Because Sabbath school exists because of Jesus Christ. Nothing else. Everything else is wrong. Because we said eternal life is to know you and Jesus Christ. When you go to the best university, I talked to my son who wanted to study at McGill, Montreal. I said to him, McGill will not give you a degree in eternal life. It doesn't exist. You can go to Harvard, Yale, Stanford, the best universities. They cannot give you a degree about eternal life. And Sabbath school is the school when you study how to have eternal life, how to know better Jesus Christ. This is why I come back to this idea. A mother knows that her authority depends on her love. Do you understand this idea? There is no authority by position. Probably 200 years ago, yes, this was the case. Even when I was a small child, when you say, he is pastor, oh, immediately you are just, he's pastor. Today, he's pastor. Who cares? This is how it happens. People understand that authority doesn't come through position. The authority comes through the experience of God. And when you are close to God, when you are serving, then they understand. So please don't complain. Don't be negative. Be just positive. Help people to change their life. Especially because even our children, they change all the time. Do you agree that they change all the time? Mark Twain, he said, when I was a boy of 14, my father was so ignorant, I could hardly stand to have the old man around. But when I got to be 21, I was astonished at how much the old man had learned in 7 years. You see the difference? The opinion of children when they are 14 and 21 is totally different. 14 is one thing, 16 is another thing, 18 is another thing. Give them the chance to just go differently, to see the world from a new perspective. Teenagers are almost adults. They have the body of an adult. And they didn't have the time of their brain to be at the level of an adult. So they are trying to discover their new body. And this is their new body. And when they look at their body, they understand very often that they are strangers to themselves. So during that evolution, they need someone who will be for them a reference. And that reference will never change. They know that their mother or father will like them whatever happens. And it is very hard. It is very hard. But if we don't give them that reference, they will always try to find something to compare, to follow that evolution of themselves. So we need to give them the chance, not to mention, I told you 2 years ago and you were not listening to me. For them, 2 years ago, it's so long, so difficult to accept. This is why the true family is a family where love is without condition. I don't know if you are convinced or not, but I find that this is one of the essential problems why we lose young people. I was studying the philosophy of education for 4 years in France, and I was so glad. And my professor, who was a Quebecois in France, one of the best professors that I had, he said, the essential problem of education is the problem of belonging. Do you understand the question of belonging? Young generation, they are looking to discover where they belong. So if you are not explaining to them very well, they will go where they find those who think as themselves, and they will think that they belong to them. I saw some of them, and I saw someone, I think in a special way, from Paris. He was 45 years old, and he said, I didn't find that I belong to God. And I said, okay, I will just do something on my own. And right now I know to whom I belong. But I am so strongly attached to this world that I am on my own. I am not able to come back. And this is a true story that I saw in my pastoral ministry. And I understand what is this. We don't know where we belong, so we are just going as a butterfly that's jumping. And if someone accepts us, we stay there for 1 or 2 years, and then we go to somewhere else without knowing that we belong to the eternal God who was looking for us and who was ready to come to live among us and to show us his love. This is so essential. The family relationship is a metaphor for the Christian, for the church relationship. When you read this, you have the text, exhort an older man as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters. So you see that the vocabulary is a vocabulary of family life. In the church, we are all a big family. And when I say this, do you know why we call each other brother and sister? This is not just for fun or pleasure or whatever. We are just telling everybody that all discrimination, as I said this morning, or differences, they don't exist within the church. And when they discover discrimination within the church, they are so disappointed because they thought that they will find something much better than what they have already in their life. So basically, The model of a successful church is based on a model of a successful family. Ellen White said, encourage love in the hearts of your children. Do not give them the impression that they must submit to control because it is your arbitrary will, because they are weak and you are strong, because you are the father and they are the children. If you wish to ruin your family, continue to govern by brute force, and you will surely succeed. I am not preaching liberal Christianity. I am not preaching conservative Christianity. I am just preaching biblical Christianity. And within the biblical Christianity, if you are using brute force, you're destroying your family. Probably it will not be seen right now, but in 20 years, you will see your family nowhere. Nobody likes rules as the ultimate reference. This is why Jesus said Sabbath was not made. No, I said just the Sabbath was made for man and not man for Sabbath. Jesus came to give us life in abundance. This is not against the rules, but this is just against the brute force, which is destroying. And the text says, your wife needs tenderness and love. The Lord loves her. She is much nearer the kingdom of heaven than you. I know for my wife this is so. But I would say, but she is dying by inches, and you are the one who is slowly taking her life. You can imagine this. The absence of love is killing people. Family life is not tasks, rules, routine. Family life is love. This is why eternity is very attractive to me, because it will be 24 hours a day, just love. But true agape love, sacrificial love, God's love, perfect love. This is the ideal. You can make her life happy if you will. So I'm suggesting to you, if you read the second testimony, there is an entire chapter about education, and you will see how interesting this relationship between spouses and between children and parents should be in every Seventh Day or Christian family. We need to promote tenderness and love. We are created for this. We are not created for rules. Do you remember when we had the Garden of Eden, when our humanity had Garden of Eden? God said just one rule. Just one. Do whatever you want. I'm just telling you, it is not unlimited, uncontrolled freedom. I'm just telling you, this tree is not for you. That you accept the limits. Today, our society wants to eliminate all limits. And right now, you don't have taboo. You don't have things that are not good. Therefore, you have no holiness. You have nothing that will be important. And everything can be questioned. I would suggest that we come back to God's concept, where you have rules, but rules of love. And rules of love are 10 and not 1,000. 10, just 10. And you can summarize 10 in 2 and 2 in 1. This is what Jesus did himself. How to go? Okay. The necessary values for healthy families with all purity. The importance for us is to do it without calculating. Do you understand the idea? Without calculating. I had the opportunity to be part of so many nominating committees. It is very unfortunate when you see that someone has an idea, a plan, and he's willing to accomplish his own plan. The nominating committees are not working in this way. I will just give you an example. I was sent to a church with some difficulties. And they asked the conference to do nominating process. And my president said to me, it will be very hard. I hope that you will finish everything in 1 month. Okay, so let's do it. So I came there, I prayed, I prepared everything that I could, and we started. And very soon we came to the election of the elders. Easy. Very quickly, we finished elders, deacons, easy, church board members, everything was easy. I said to the conference president, you told me this is very difficult. We already finished elders, we finished everything. Wait until the end, you will understand. They came, all departments were okay. They came to the music director. And within the church, they had, I would say, 3 PhD in music and probably 7, 8 MA in music. And I don't know how many bachelors. And they had the best choir in the area. And they did international concerts and everything. When we started to do director of music, we spent almost 2 days. You will not believe. You will not believe. Almost 2 days. I said, how it is possible? And I understood. If you put someone who has a PhD and as director of music, two others who are PhD in music and are not elected, will not accept easily. And if by chance you say, this guy is a good spiritual leader and he's only MA in music, let's put him. Well, you have everybody against you. And then I said, we need to stop. I need some sermons to open the Bible and to explain everything. And this is how we did. Purity means not only a pure, no sin. This is not. This is, we are transparent. We don't have an idea behind that we want to manipulate, to use people. We are just accepting people as they are. We are not trying to promote ourselves or even others that we like. We are accepting the life of the church, of the family, with all purity. So my friends, don't forget that one of the essential characteristics of a successful family life or church life is really purity. If you are preparing cakes, and I know that you're preparing fantastic cake, and your teenagers understand that behind the cake, there is something that they have to do. They will not appreciate your cake as you would like them to appreciate. Do you understand my point? So when you're doing something, do everything because you love them. Not because you calculate, not because you have a plan on project. And you prepare a very good cake, and then you say, could you please go and buy for me this and this? And he understands, I understand why the cake was there. All purity means transparency. I have no plans and project. My only concern is how to fulfill God's plan and God's project. Honor widows who are really widows. This is a very nice speech. At that time, 2,000 years ago, we can find what we find even today. In some countries, people, they come because of fish and bread and not because of the gospel. But I understand that at that time, widows were accepted within the church only after 60 years of age. It's very interesting. Because at that time, they didn't have social security system. And so the church was the social security system. The church applied the principles of the gospel. So they took care of true widows, but not younger than 60. And if you read 1 Timothy, you will understand this very well. Honoring the members of our families, but those who are members with transparency. Let's continue because I don't want to spend too much time there. In the time of the Apostle Paul, a true widow was an individual without protection. I like this Persian story. A man with 10 children, and question was asked, what is your preferred child? And his answer was, my preferred child is he who is sick until he is healed, he who is sad until he is joyful, he who is angry until he is peaceful, he who is lonely until he feels friendship. You have the entire page only about this. So basically, if someone is in trouble, we will help him until he is healed. And then we will focus on other people in need. This is the true family life. Let me say something very important for me. I put here at the end the story of the nursing home in Chicago. Normally, it is the duty of children to take care of their parents. This is normally. I visited a sister of our church from Bulgaria. She was in a very rich, wealthy nursing home called the Greek American Nursing Home, somewhere very close to the airport in Chicago. And usually I used my afternoon time for visiting. And so I came in general around 3 o'clock. One day they had birthday party. Second time that I came once a month. Second month, birthday party. Third month, birthday party. So it was good for me. You have birthday cake and you eat and it is nice. Then I asked the supervisor, the nurse, how it happens that every time that I come, you have birthday parties? And she said, these are old people, and we talk to the families, and families ask to do something that everybody likes. And we agree together that everybody likes birthday parties. So we chose, together with the family, everyone will celebrate 12 times his birthday. Every month. So you were born 23rd of month. Every 23rd of month, they will celebrate. So it was very nice. And I talked to all of them. And suddenly I saw this old lady on my side and another old lady on my right side. And she said to me, I'm so glad that you came to visit your mother. And I said to her, this is not my mother. I'm her pastor. She's the member of my church. Oh, even more, I'm so glad that as pastor you came to visit your member. You know, I'm nobody. Nobody's visiting me. And she said that she has 4 sons. Nobody's visiting her. And I would like to suggest you never come to this situation. I know that sometimes it can be difficult, but the true biblical concept is that family is taking care of all members. This is biblical. If all of you agree for a nursing home and everything, praise the Lord. But take care of your members. This is how it happens there. And this is, let me see. No. This is the last one that I wanted to say. The real widow trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. The basic element for family life is prayer. And I'm telling you this. Introduce prayer not as a burden, short prayers, but everybody in family should understand that you are connected with a supernatural power. Nobody can work against you. And I like this text. The real widow trusts in God and continues in supplication and prayers night and days. They're talking about other widows. Other widows live in pleasures. Pleasures are destroying our intimate life, are destroying our eternity, and making us slaves. Pleasures are good if they are pleasures given by God. And that sometimes is difficult. How can you enjoy an apple when you have just beside gibanica I kolače, one na tri sprata ili tako dalje? It is very difficult. But this is, the true pleasures are given by God. If not, you become slaves. And I want to say, everything that I said can be summarized in one thing. If, this is the end of the text, if you forget to treat your family with love, you are worse than an unbeliever. Take it seriously. Don't forget. Invest in your family. Spend time. Too much work. Who cares? They are priorities. My situation is difficult because I work for the church. This is for God's kingdom. And I'm trying to do my efforts, and I need to do better. But globally speaking, we need to invest more in our families. Seventh-day Adventists should be strong about families. And I can tell you right now, the main problem, don't understand me wrongly, the main problem in the future would be because individuals will be different, families will be different, nations will be different. If you want me to explain, I can. But the reality that the question of different families, when you have 2 mothers or 2 fathers, or you can have, I don't know, 3 fathers and 2 mothers, all living together. I saw so many crazy stuff. This is just destabilizing God's project. Please invest in biblical families. This is the best answer for what you can see today. As I say, individuals will be different. Transgender people, they are different than we are. How can you communicate easily with them? We need to communicate to them. At the same time, to continue to promote God's project for every individual. God's project, not our project. And the third thing, all nations will be different. This is coming very, very surely. In all this unfriendly context, in this adversity, Stay strongly on the family side and God will bless you. Enjoy your life, your family life, your church life, and I'm sure that all things will go right for you, for your family, and for your church. Amen.
Thank you so much for those words. They're like a sonic boom, and we need to echo those words. And I thank you so much for everybody for listening and for those who participated. God will put his love and truth into our minds because we belong to Daddy. We belong to Daddy, and we're for each other. Let us stand as we sing, We Will Serve the Lord. Do you have it on screen? Would it be on screen? No? 328? 338. Okay, let us stand and sing hymn number 338. 338. What'd you sing?
Pray. Our Heavenly Father,
Father, thank you so much for your word and for the certitude that you love our families, our churches, each and everyone. Thank you for the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, helping us to be more and more like Jesus. So please help us also to understand that if we don't invest in our families, we are just out of your project. And we would like to ask you to give us your wisdom, to help us to promote a friendly relationship and a good relationship in our families in order to grow in the likeness of Jesus Christ. May we promote love, understanding, tenderness, and may we appreciate one another, knowing that we are doing all things, preparing ourselves for your kingdom, where we will live with these principles forever. I am praying for each and everyone present here and our families. I am praying also for the courage in order to establish priorities in our life and to have more time to invest in our families. Forgive us for what we did wrongly for so many years and help us to do the right things for ourselves, for our salvation, but also for the next generation. And thank you for the certitude that you will help us to be different, to live a transformed life by your grace. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.